HarperCollins presents New Voices, The Guardian Fourth Estate BAME Short Story Prize 2017. Written and read by Lisa Smith, Arun Das, Avani Shah, Henry Wong, Kit Fan, and Jimi Famurewa.
Auld Lang Syne by Lisa Smith. In all his 52 years in England, Rufus Samuels had never once been in trouble with the law. Now, here he was, under arrest. The handcuffs pinched at his wrists, but he sat upright in the back seat of the squad car. It was important to maintain dignity and composure. They couldn't keep him here. He'd demand a phone call, although he didn't know any lawyers. For a brief moment, Rufus considered contacting Pearl, but quickly dismissed the idea. He didn't need her. He could sort it out. At the first opportunity, he would explain in a polite but firm manner that he hadn't done anything wrong, that this was all a misunderstanding, and he was another black man who was the victim of wrongful arrest. Not many men his age could carry off a Prince of Wales check, together with his favourite cardinal red shirt and matching handkerchief. Rufus knew that he looked crisp. It was the outfit he'd worn at his wedding last May, and although his fourth wedding had been a low-key event, he'd seen no reason not to treat himself to some new threads. He'd felt as special in this three-piece suit as he had done in the charcoal grey one he'd worn back in August 1963, when he married Daphne Thompson at Ephra Road Baptist Chapel. That day, he'd received almost as many compliments as his bride. So after that, he got all his good suits tailored by Monty, the Bajan on Walworth Road. He didn't have a single one of those suits anymore. His second wife, Esme, took her shears to them when she found out he slept with Brenda from the laundrette. He'd always thought that if she'd shown as much passion in bed as she'd taken out on his wardrobe, then he never would have been tempted to stray in the first place. Rufus inspected the other people the police had lined up in the custody suite's foyer. Surely, everyone could see that a man like him shouldn't be in such a place. Connie was probably waiting for him at the New Year's Eve party, ready to welcome him with a can of red stripe and a plate of curry goat and rice. He'd never believe that his good friend Rufus, big man Samuels, was standing in a queue behind a middle-aged man whose tummy bulged over his tracksuit bottoms and some ute whose jeans crotch hung down to his knees. They kept him waiting while a bail dodger, a drug dealer, and a drunken disorderly were processed and then taken down to the cells. Each time, they'd been led over to a set of double doors, which folded backwards at the press of a button. In the cells, a baritone was slurring his way through Auld Lang Syne. His voice drifted into the foyer before the double doors sidled shut. The young police constable who had brought Rufus to the station guided him into the yellow square painted on a lino in front of the custody sergeant's desk. The handcuffs were removed, and Rufus straightened his back, pulling himself up to his full height, 5'10". He estimated the police lady behind the desk was in her early to mid-40s. Her dark hair was scraped into a tight knot on the top of her head, making her face look pinched, severe. Rufus thought that with a little rouge on her cheeks, she might be pretty. He'd dated a couple of white women back in the 70s. He smiled at the brunette. She didn't smile back. "Name and time of arrest," she asked the policeman at his side. "This is Rufus Harold Samuels. Time of arrest was 2100 hours. Circumstances, please." "Me dear lady, me don't want to waste any more of your time. There are no circumstances. Everything has been blown apart of proportion. You see..." The custody sergeant cut Rufus dead with a look. This was the sort of woman who didn't like being interrupted. Best to keep quiet and bide his time. The young officer relayed the events in police language, formal, stilted. Rufus listened. He would have given a better account of what had occurred. It was clear this copper didn't grasp the complexity of his domestic situation. After all, he was just a boy. Mr. Samuels, I'm going to authorise your detention so that we can act on the information my colleague has reported and give you the opportunity to provide an explanation. Now empty your pockets. Me beg you not tip me hat. Sorry? Madam, me would like to keep me hat if it's all right with you. It's my lucky hat. I'm in the one to catch a draft and be sick come New Year's Day. They confiscated Rufus's mobile phone, his wallet, his watch, his tie, and cufflinks. They even took his shoelaces. He was allowed to keep his Homburg after they checked the lining and the brim. Are you on any medication? Custody Sergeant asked in her monotone. Rufus was 72, but believed he could still pass for 60. He had always taken pride in his physical appearance and had been able to maintain his athletic build, his slender waist and barrel chest, until well into middle age. Then came a diagnosis of high blood pressure, then diabetes, and after that he started having a sort of trouble associated with an enlarged prostate. But all the men he played dominoes with at the Duke of Sussex had the same problems. "You're as old as the woman you feel," was Connie's philosophy. Cheryl was 36, healthy and strong. The bolt on the cell door echoed as it shot home. Rufus overheard the policemen conversing as they retreated along the corridor. "What's Grandad in for?" asked the Asian custody officer, wearing a loud suit in a built-up area. "Domestic," his arresting officer replied. "Blimey, has he asked for a lawyer?" "Nah, he does want a phone call, though." Rufus padded carefully across the cell floor. Without the laces, his brogues were large and awkward. The blue plastic mattress spread across a narrow cot was thin and cold against his backside as he sat down. He inhaled, catching a whiff of sweat and booze. In a neighbouring cell, the baritone began slurring his way through Auld Lang Syne again. A younger, gruffer male voice shouted, "Shut the fuck up!" The singing continued. "I said shut the fuck up!" gruff voice repeated. The baritone stopped. "You shut the fuck up!" he shouted. "No, you shut the fuck up! Go fuck yourself! No, you go fuck yourself!" Their expletives echoed up and down the corridor for around 5 minutes. Then there was silence. Rufus took off his hat and allowed his head to rest against the concrete wall. His mind drifted back to this time last year and the moment Cheryl arrived at the community centre, dressed in that white strapless gown. It clung to her bosom, slipped over her hips and hugged her broad backside, before cascading in folds with silver sequins down to the tiled floor. Cheryl and her girlfriend stood at the edge of the dance floor, with their Beyoncé-style weaves clutching Bacardi breezes. Being red-skinned, Rufus wasn't usually attracted to women of a darker complexion. Cheryl's smooth blue-black skin had the luster of a Nubian woodcarving. Expertly applied makeup accentuated her chiselled jawline and hollowed cheeks, features he would normally call handsome rather than beautiful. It was the assurance in her step and the swing of her waist that had truly mesmerised him. His eyes were drawn to her all night as she glided around the hall, the sequins on her frock leaving a trail from the buffet to the bar and all around the dance floor. At first, he watched from a safe vantage point, but as if wound in by some invisible wire, Rufus found himself at her elbow when the clock struck midnight. She turned and raised an eyebrow.
"So, me watchdog day for your approach at last?"
"Me no watchdog. Me just like to look pon beautiful woman."
"And me like man with moustache," she said,
a gold canine glinting as she smiled. She bowed her head to plant a waxy kiss on his mouth. "Happy New Year," she said.
"For auld lang syne, my dear, for auld lang syne."
The baritone along the corridor had resumed his caroling. Rufus shook his head. With it being New Year's Eve, the cells would soon begin to fill up. Might he end up having to share with some drunken ruffian? Did Cheryl realise what she was putting him through? Rufus heard the keys twist in the lock. The cell door opened, and a white policeman in his 50s was standing beside the custody officer. "Mr. Rufus Samuels, come with me, please." There was a long, dull tone. Rufus shifted in the hard plastic seat and waited for the note to end. At last, he could get this whole thing sorted out. The room he now sat in was almost as bare as the cell, except it had carpet and a table where he sat across from the policeman. There was also a clock on the wall. It was 22:10. Connie's party would be well underway by now. He indulged himself in imagining that Connie was ringing his mobile at that very moment, or hurrying to his flat, concerned, anxious to find out why Rufus hadn't made it to the party yet. They'd met in 1961, while on a double date with twins Letitia and Denise McIntosh. The men hit it off with each other more than they did with the sisters. Their mutual love of rum, dominoes, gambling and women had made them firm friends. Over the years, they had loaned each other money and slept on each other's couches, and Connie had been Rufus's best man for 3 of his 4 weddings. Surely, Connie would have noticed his absence by now. The note ceased. Rufus sat up straight and looked the policeman in the eye. "For the benefit of the tape, please state your name."
"Rufus Harold Samuels."
"I am Sergeant Daniel Parsons of the Prisoner Handling Unit. Mr. Samuels, you've waived your right to have legal representation during this interview, but should you change your mind, you can request a lawyer at any time. Do you understand?"
"Yes."
"Mr. Samuels, you've been brought here under caution following an incident at 12B Hercules Tower. Mrs. Cheryl Marcia Samuels alleges that you assaulted her, is that correct?"
"Well, Sergeant Parsons."
"Daniel, this whole situation just blew up from nothing. We're getting ready to go to my best friend's New Year's Eve party. It's a friends and family type of thing he's been having for the past 30 years. Anyway, Cheryl came out of the bedroom in a sharp, tight-up frock, more of a nightclub type of outfit than a nice party dress. Now, I tell her that she looked nice, but I say I thought it was a little revealing for Connie's party. After all, it's a community centre we go to, not a dance hall."
"You took offence to what your wife was wearing?"
"Yes, man. Me like her to dress nice, but at 36, she neither chick nor child, and I have no business going to a family party dressed like that. Are you married, Daniel?"
"It's Sergeant Parsons."
"Yes. I am happily married, and I don't tell my wife what to wear."
"Good for you. I'm glad your wife's clothes not give you any cause for concern.
But you understand, a husband should be able to offer him wife his opinion, no?"
"Had you been drinking?"
"No, sir. We were saving myself for the party."
"Would you say you have a problem with your wife making up her own mind, making her own decisions?"
"Uh-uh. I thought we were going to have a discussion about her apparel."
"Did you become angry, Mr. Samuels?"
"Listen, Daniel, Sergeant Parsons, I am a reasonable man. When we first met, she did seem like a reasonable woman. Quick-tempered, but me like women with a bit of spirit, you know? Lately, me can't put a foot right with her. And tonight, she just went crazy upon me."
"Your wife alleges that you assaulted her, that you held her by the wrists?"
"Well, I lie, she a tell. And I saw it go."
Rufus paused, picturing the smirk on Cheryl's face as she prodded his chest with her index finger. He recalled the raspy tone of her voice.
"She say to me, what make it..."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.